The MMA Discussion Podcast brought to you by sportsofanarchy.com. Visit the site for all of your sporting needs and news. We're also brought to you by our sponsor, submissionfc.com. You use the promo code sportsofanarchy10 for 10% off of your order at submissionfc.com for all the best Brazilian jiu-jitsu gear. I am your admin, Nick Peralta, also brought to you with here the editor of sportsofanarchy.com, Chris Pagliuca. How you doing, brother?
I'm good. How are you, man?
Oh, I feel awesome. Awake and alert and ready to get this done. Let's do it.
Yeah, it's early in the morning, guys.
We are going to preview UFC Fight Night, Swanson versus Edgar, going down this Saturday in Austin, Texas. A very stacked card, I would say. There's some...
It's a good Fight Night card, for sure.
Oh, definitely. Worth every penny that you're not going to spend on it, because it's free on TV. Definitely. You got, from top to bottom, there's many, many, many notable names. So, it just going down from the bottom. Also, one of my favorite things about this card is it's going to finally, we're going to start to integrate women's strongweight fights. One of which, in this card, features Paige VanZant versus Kaylin Curran. Curran, of course, being part of the famous Curran family. And Paige VanZant, who has trained at multiple spots such as the Lion's Den and Team Alpha Male.
She was supposed to be on this season of Tough, but she was too young. She's 20, I think.
20 years. Yes.
Yeah, she's my age. You have to be 21 to get on Tough.
Yeah, because there's all that alcohol going around. Features also Eves Edwards, James Vick, Texas native, Luke Barnett, Ruslan Magomedov, all on the prelims card. And then on the main card, we got guys like Matt Wyman, Isaac Valley Flag. Shout out to Isaac Valley Flag, fan of MMA Discussion. Joseph Benavidez versus Dustin Ortiz. You have a wild card fight, I guess you could say, in Jared Rolshaw versus Alessi Olenek. I would hope that guy's name right. Brad Pickett versus Chico Camus in a flyweight affair. That is a great fight, I think. At the co-main event of the evening, Bobby King Green versus Edson Barbosa. And, of course, the main event, Cub Swanson versus Frankie Edgar. A stack card.
Let's go.
Definitely. Let's start here.
There's no, like, crazy, like, big... There are only really big-name fighters, the headliner, but there's a lot of good fights on there. Just fun fights.
Yeah, of course, your average fights. Not a lot of high-ranked guys. I would say probably just Brad Pickett, Chico Camus, and Joseph Benavidez are your high-ranked guys on the card.
Yeah. I mean, there's some high-ranked guys up there, but there's no, like, really big names aside from the top of the card. But that's a fun card. There's a lot of good, fun fights on
there. Yeah, like Bobby King Green, ranked number 7 at lightweight, taking on number 13 ranked Edson Barbosa. That's a fun fight, for sure. I mean...
Yeah. Two guys who like to stand and bang.
And of course, I mean, and Bobby King Green to me is one of your best overall martial artists out there. But we'll get into that once we get to his fight. We're gonna start just going over the main card, what everybody's gonna be watching. Matt Wyman making his return versus Isaac Valley Flag. That's gonna be an interesting fight. Isaac Valley Flag, I think, if I remember correctly, coming off the fight with Takanori Gomi. I could be wrong.
I think so.
I believe
I'll check it. I'm not entirely sure, but I think you're right.
Matt Wyman has been out a while. And yes, that I am correct. The Takanori Gomi fight was his last one. Lost that one to a decision at UFC 172. He also lost the one before that against Elias Silverio. And that puts him in a tough position. Now he's 1-2 in the UFC. This is a do-or-die fight, possibly, for Isaac Valley Flag. You would say
Isaac's had more fights than 3 in the UFC, hasn't he?
Nope, just 3. He's had a lot of Strikeforce fights.
Yeah, I know that. I thought he had more than 3 fights in the UFC.
Looking it over, he's fought Eves Edwards, won that fight in his debut. Then fought Elias Silverio at UFC Fight Night, Rockhold versus Philippou at the beginning of this year. Lost it, and then lost to Takanori Gomi in April.
Yeah.
And that's all. So yeah, he's in a tough spot. Matt Wyman, veteranized fighter. Definitely, it's hard to tell a fight with that guy. That guy's...
Hasn't fought in almost 2 years.
Really? When was his last fight?
January of 2013, lost to TJ Grant.
Oh my goodness. Oh yeah, I remember that fight. But I didn't know that was his last fight. Wow. He may have been out. I wonder why he's been out. Let's look that up. We gotta know why. I need to know why. It's gonna bother me if I don't know.
Who knows? Let's just check it out. I wonder if he was injured or he just took time off for a certain reason, but that's a long time to be out for.
Yeah, I guess he just took time off. Think about Matt Wyman. He's a tough veteran, been around, has stayed around for quite a while now. Looking at his record, he's never really kept a big streak going, but he's surprised some fighters.
He loses to like the top guys he seems to lose to, and then he's able to beat these other guys.
So he's your bona fide gatekeeper, I guess you could say.
Well, I guess. I mean, he hasn't fought in 2 years, so I'm not sure if he's
even
a gatekeeper. But, I mean, he beat Paul Sass, Mac Danzig he beat twice, Cole Miller. And then he lost to guys like Jim Miller and TJ Grant, higher ranked guys. Seaver he lost to.
Just based off that, he's been around. Dude has been around, and dude can shock guys. I remember for the Paul Sass fight, he was highly, the very heavy underdog in that fight, which is surprising, even though Paul Sass was just, this hot up-and-comer at the time. All win submissions, I believe, and then he goes in there with Paul Sass, actually happens to defeat him with a submission. Matt Wyman, but you never know, the ring rust could affect him. There's definitely that.
The ring rust might play as the biggest factor in this fight. This fight's going to go everywhere, I think. I think this is just going to be like a fight that it's going to be on the feet. It's going to go to the ground. I think it might be a closer. I think it's going to go to decision. I think it's going to be pretty close, but I think Wyman will probably come away with it.
How dare you predict decisions? That's just like kind of like, karma.
I mean, I think it's going to be a fun fight. I don't think these guys are going to finish it. I think it's going to be like a close fight. There'll be some close submissions. Someone's going to get rocked probably sometime in the fight, but I think Wyman's going to come away with it.
I think so too. I think experience kills. I think it'll kill in this fight. I think Wyman will come prepared, ready, hopefully healthy. Isaac Valley Flag, is coming in a more fresher fighter. He's fought twice this year already. One thing about Isaac Valley Flag, I will say this, is that he's also kind of this unpredictable fighter, because going into Strikeforce, he was this grappler, known as a grappler, came in and started showing off some hands, and then in the UFC, has been lackluster thus far, but has shown a willingness to trade in the Takanori Gomi fight, a very exciting fight, one fight of the night, I believe. Dude's willing to trade, dude's willing to get down and dirty, willing to get in your face, and against a guy like Matt Wyman. I think that trait holds well. I think if he can get on the inside of Wyman, start beating him up, Wyman's going to have to try and, go to his grappling, I would say. And then Isaac Valley Flag is already known for having a great grappling game. So it's definitely close.
It should be a good fight.
It should be a good fight, yeah.
TJ Grant, his last fight, that was a pretty good fight as well.
Oh, definitely. But TJ Grant at the time was, being TJ Grant.
Exactly.
So there's no shame in that loss.
Not at all.
Yes, awesome headliner. I mean, this is a close fight. Definitely very hard and tough to call, but it's a sleeper fight. Could definitely be fight of the night. You never know.
Yeah, it's one of those fights that these guys aren't the biggest names. You've seen them fight. If you're a hardcore fan, you've seen them fight, but you don't really. It's hard to gauge. This one's definitely hard to gauge.
Yeah, and I mean, but think about this also. Fun statistic for Matt Wyman. He has 4 fight of the nights. Award.
Yeah, that's what I was saying, and it should definitely be an exciting one.
Awesome. And yeah, and just like I said, Isaac Valley Flag won one in his last fight. This is going to be an awesome fight. Great starter fight. Can't wait for it. Moving on to the flyweight division. Joseph Benavidez versus Dustin Ortiz. Now, this is a very tough fight for Dustin Ortiz. Toughest to date, especially. Yeah, the biggest fight of his career, on the biggest stage of his career, definitely, I think. I don't know how many main cards he's been on, but
he's fought on a few main cards. This might not be the biggest. I mean, yeah, he's fought on a few main cards. I couldn't get the right word out, but it might not be the biggest stage for him, but it's up there.
Yeah, well, I mean, as far as pay-per-views, he hasn't competed on one yet. He's been on he has been on UFC on Fox, but that was a prelim.
Yeah, so I mean, it is a big fight for him. I think he was on the preliminary card of that UFC on Fox 11 card.
Yes. And so with this fight, Dustin has a huge task ahead of him. Joseph Benavidez, he's been out a while, but is Joseph Benavidez. You know what I mean? The number, the consensus number two guy in the world at that weight class, if not.
Yeah, I think I see him as number three behind Dodson, but he's still like he's that guy who.
Demetrius
Johnson, no one can beat him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I was saying that as if, you know, Dodson was number one and, and Johnson. Yeah, the way the UFC has their rankings, yeah, our rankings, yeah, we would probably put him as number three on sportsofanarchy.com. Joseph Benavidez, one of the probably the reason why he's that good is because he can fight anywhere. He's a striker, grappler.
Yeah. Very good submissions, that underrated submission game. Yeah, he's a wrestler. Those guys at Team Alpha Milk seems like they could do it all.
Yeah, exactly. And
And
he had a great showing this year at 172, I believe it was. I can't remember. I think that's what it was. Against Tim Elliott, and that was a great fight. Dude put a choking on one of the top 10 guys in the world. Yeah, that pretty quick.
Mounted. It was a weird mounted.
Yeah, he had a mounted guillotine, and he had his legs closing in on his arm, like he had his arms trapped with his legs. It was sick. It was ridiculous. Yeah,
yeah. Was that UFC 172, the Jones versus Glover fight?
Oh, good memory. Although, unless you're reading it.
I definitely went to Sherdog.
How dare you? All right, anyway. Dustin Ortiz, for anybody that doesn't know, Dustin Ortiz is one of these guys. He's a scrappy dude. Comes in, fight. He also has good offensive wrestling. We've never seen him on the defense yet.
Yeah, he's losing his last few fights. I mean, and even just looking at his record right now, his last three fights have all gone to split decision. He had the loss to Moraga, which was very close. Then he had that Ray Borg fight, which I thought he won. And then he recently just fought Justin Scoggins, who's one of the biggest upcoming prospects. And that was another really, really close fight. It could have went either way, and it was a split decision for Ortiz.
Yeah, so, I mean, that doesn't bode well for him. You know, if he's struggling with all these up-and-comers, The fact that he's...
Moraga fought for the title, and then Ray Borg is more of an up-and-comer, but Scoggins was one of the most impressive guys in the division, in my opinion.
For sure. I mean, he's definitely on the cusp of being ranked, I would say, if he's not already.
I don't believe he is.
Yeah, at least not in our rankings.
I don't think he is on the UFC's rankings either, but he might be towards the bottom of the
rankings. But he's there. He's close. He's mid-tier, I would say, for sure.
And he's one of those guys. He's young. I'm not sure how old exactly Scoggins is, but I know he's very young, and he doesn't have a lot of professional fights. I think he has, like, maybe 10.
Yeah.
He's, like, 21, 22 years old. I think in a few years, this guy could be something big in the division.
Yeah, but also remember this. Big thing about Dustin is he's also young. Joseph Benavidez is in what would many consider his athletic prime at age 30. Ortiz is young, 25. Not to say that those wins didn't mean anything, but they were against, you know, mid-tier guys, I would say. And the fact that they were split decisions shows how close those fights were. In which it kind of tells you how tough of a fight this really is going to be for him. Unless he can go in there and just absolutely stun and surprise Joseph Benavidez, I do not see him getting out of there, even in the full three rounds. I see Joseph Benavidez.
Benavidez at all. I think Benavidez does come away with a finish.
Yes. Let's be...
Ortiz's losses, he's never been finished, which is interesting. All three of his losses have come by decision.
Well, let's see if he can... I think that'll also be another big challenge, not being finished. Being able to hang in there, he's got to find some kind of a way to be offensive against Joseph, and that's really hard with a guy like Joseph, who's definitely comes forward hard, fast-paced. And Dustin Ortiz, the thing I was saying earlier was that he's never been one of the things about his fights and all of that that have been in the UFC thus far, he's never been challenged grappling-wise. Benavidez can easily challenge him to that. And so we will be able to see truly how
tough. He had some good exchanges with Scoggins grappling-wise. They were fun. And I'm pretty sure he had some with Moraga. But, I mean, I think Benavidez is going to be able to come out there, out-will him in the takedowns, and I think he'll be able to find a submission. And when you look at Benavidez, his only losses have come to Demetrius Johnson and Dominic Cruz, two to each guy. And those are two of the best guys in the world. So, I think that no one outside of those two guys and maybe possibly someone else like John Dodson are going to beat Benavidez.
Probably true. I mean, definitely you got to also you got to also figure that they're going to be hold on, sorry about that. Technical difficulties on my mic here.
No worries.
All right, fix that. But yeah, Joseph Benavidez is going to have a tough one. Or I mean, Dustin Ortiz is gonna have a tough one. If he can, it will probably easily be the biggest upset on the card, I would say. Other than that, let's see what happens. Definitely gonna be interesting to see what he can come up with.
Outside of championship fights, you don't really expect a guy like Benavidez to lose.
Yeah, same here. Jared Rolshaw versus Alexei Oleinik.
Yeah.
Man, that's a tough name. If for anybody that doesn't know about Oleinik, I'm just gonna refer to him by his last name. It's readable. He actually defeated Mirko Kokop in MMA competition last year. Other than that, that's really all you got from the guy. But what we do know about him is his submissions are insane. The guy goes in there and just puts dudes away. And this is a heavyweight fight, by the way, the only one on the card. Jared Rolshaw, it's hard to put a wrap around this guy considering without sounding like, you know, mean. But he's more of a wrestling-based fighter, we will say that.
Yeah, he's the guy who goes in there, he takes you down, and just wears you out. Jared Rolshaw, I'm pretty sure he trains with Hendricks at Team Takedown, right?
I'm actually not sure. But if he does, then that makes a lot of sense where he gets his training on his wrestling. There's a lot of wrestling-based fighters there.
Yeah, he's a very strong wrestler. I mean, and Alexei, looking at his record, his first UFC fight was against Anthony Hamilton. He won by neck crank. He also, before that, he beat Krokop, as you mentioned, by neck crank. The guy has 40 submission wins out of his 49 total wins.
Insanity.
It's just ridiculous. But he hasn't been facing the same level of competition.
Oh, no.
In the UFC, which makes a lot of sense as to why he has all these wins.
And you think about it, too, also, if you look at his losses, that tells another story, too. He's lost to guys like Jeff Monsoon, Chris Tuschier, which is, you know, not good.
Yeah, I think Rose Holt is going to have a pretty easy time.
Oh, my goodness. He even has a loss to Chill Sonnen.
Does he really?
Yes, he does. Early on in his career in 2006.
That's pretty funny. I think Rose Holt is going to come out, just do what he does, get the takedown, and just stay on top of the guy, and he'll probably just work out a decision.
Yeah, yeah. We'll see. I mean, it's definitely interesting when you got a guy who has this kind of you know, background in submissions and being able to sub all these guys against a guy that's going to willingly try and take him down throughout the whole fight. And let's see what he can do. See what he can do off his back. If he's good off of his back defensive-wise, if he can do sweeps. It'd be interesting. I actually think this is an interesting matchup for Rolshaw, in which other fights you couldn't really tell. For this one, I'm actually excited. Now, only because now that we've learned more about Oleinik, this definitely makes it an interesting fight.
Yeah, and I mean, the Rolshaw, he does have a victory over Soa Politely, who's looked great. Mm-hmm. If guys can't stop his takedown, all three of his wins have come via decision, unanimous decision in the UFC. He's been able to take guys down and just have his way with them. If you can't stop his takedown, you're not going to beat this guy.
That tells a big story, too. But you got to be careful with those submissions, man. You never know what could happen off a dude's back.
I think Oleinik's more of a top fighting guy. I think he gets a lot of his submissions from the top, from like mount, from side control, stuff like that. I think that's where he finds most of his submissions. I don't think he's really a guard guy, so who knows. But I do think Rosalt is going to come away with this one.
All right. I'm actually going to back you, the Ukrainian, here. I think mainly because he is he's also an international master of sports in combat sambo, which to me is impressive.
Yeah, those sambo guys are really tough too.
Especially, yeah. And sambo is a great weapon to have in there against a wrestler, especially a wrestler who probably doesn't have much experience against sambo guys.
It's the closest thing to MMA, I would say.
Yeah. And that's what makes it interesting against his grappling. And if Oleinik is a guy that likes taking dudes down, getting on top, and finding a submission on the top, who's to say with that sambo experience, with his grappling experience, that he can't take Jared Rolshaw down and get on top? And so with that, I'm going to back Oleinik.
Yeah, I don't think that's very likely, but I get what you're saying.
All right. Well, see, now you and I have both made this a very interesting reason to go watch this fight now. Because at first, looking at it, you're like, I don't know. But now, I'm excited. Yeah,
most likely, if you're just a casual fan, you haven't heard of either of these guys.
Well, yeah. Watch it get thrown around, I'm telling you. It'll be interesting. I'm backing Oleinik, the Ukrainian. We'll see what happens.
Sorry to get off topic a little bit here, but just looking at the card, I'm actually really surprised that they put Paige VanZant versus Curran in on the Fight Pass prelims.
I know, that's messed up. I mean, especially when you have
because they, I would figure they'd want to show off their new division and put them maybe on somewhere in the Fox Sports 1 prelims.
Especially with a woman like Paige VanZant, who's very talked about these days. Who has been talked about as far
she's
as...
She's a young girl. She's a good-looking girl. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just... It's easy to...
She chains with a top-name gym.
Division, especially if that's a good fight.
Yeah, and she changed with a top-name gym in Team Alpha Male. She's also
Apparently, I heard them a while ago saying she, like, left Team Alpha Male and started training back at her home gym, but... I'm not exactly sure what's going on with that.
Home gym. Well, her home gym, as she said herself, the source being when she was interviewed on the MMA Hour, was that she trained at Lion's Den. It was the very first gym she trained at and just stuck it out there until she came to California and started training with Team Alpha Male. If that's the case, then I would think she's back at Team Lion's Den.
I'm not sure exactly what gym she went back to, but she did say that she left Team Alpha Male for a little bit.
Well, that makes... Makes it an even more interesting fight. And yeah, you're right. Again, because of the name power that she has, because of it being a new division, you would think that they want to put it on the Fight Sports 1 prelims.
Yeah, I would think just not even because of her name, but I think just because of it's a new division. They're having the Ultimate Fighter come in, and they're having all these girls at strawweight come in. I would think they want to show off the division a little bit more than putting it on Fight Pass.
Definitely.
Because, I mean, most people who have Fight Pass probably know of her. Mm-hmm. I think you want to get this fight on TV.
Definitely. Big mistake, UFC. You heard it from us.
Yeah.
All right. How dare you?
Our opinions matter.
Yes. Make it known, fight fans. Let's move on. That's halfway through the card already. The next flyweight fight up on it. Definitely more important as far as rankings go. Brad Pickett versus Chico Camus. And I'm excited mainly because Chico Camus should have been at flyweight a while ago, I think. He's a small dude, but he's a successful dude. He's a guy that goes in there, it doesn't matter, doesn't let size dictate the fight. Goes in there, he's scrappy, he on the ground and on the feet, and he's an exciting fighter. He's a tough fighter. He has a good tank on him. And against a guy like Brad Pickett, that makes this an even more exciting matchup for me. I think Brad Pickett, you know, being the guy that he is, the guy that could put dudes down in one punch, obviously, hence the nickname. It's going to be exciting, definitely. I think the speed and boxing advantage goes to Chico, though. He's fast. He's got good hands. He's trained at Rufus Sport for a majority of his career. And, man, that's a great fight.
Yeah, Chico Camus is a good. He's a tough guy. He's definitely good. The move to 125 is definitely going to help him out. But I do think Brad Pickett's going to come away with this one just because of he's more experienced guy. I mean, he's fought higher level competition. Uh-huh. And even though he has had a little bit of trouble against, like, the higher ranked guys, like he lost to Ian McCall in his last fight. He did lose to Michael McDonald at 135. Uh-huh. He has been able to beat a lot of tough guys. He beat Mike Easton. He beat Yves Dubuin. He beat Neil Seary. I mean, he's a tough guy in his own right. He's a hard guy to finish it, too. I think he's only been knocked out once in his career. I mean, he is submittable, but the guy's hard to finish.
Definitely. But look at Chico Camus. He's a tough dude as well. He has had trouble in the past. He's lost to Dustin Kimura by submission. Other than that, the real legitimate loss, like the real just loss that really sent him to going down the flyweight, was the loss to Ultimate Fighter winner Chris Holdsworth. In a fight where he was just insanely smaller. In a division where there's already small guys, he was just outsized.
Yeah, Holdsworth's a really tall guy for the division. And he was just able... Chico Camus showed a lot of good grappling defense, but for the most part, he was getting beaten that fight, just out-grappled.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, like I said, but I can't ever count Chico out. So for that, I would assume that Pickett being ranked much higher would be the favorite, the heavy favorite. I'm gonna back Chico Camus here. I think it's his time. I think he's gonna go in there. I think he's gonna shock the world.
I don't know. I think it'll be a good fight. I think it'll definitely be a good fight. But Brad Pickett's a good overall guy, even though his nickname is One Punch. More of his wins came by submission. He has 10 wins by submission, and only 7 by knockout. Even though that's also impressive. This guy's been able to beat I mean, he beat Demetrius Johnson even though that was back a long time ago. He did beat the guy, and he's just good everywhere. I don't think Camus is much better than him in the areas where he is better than him, mm-hmm. and I think the areas Pickett is better, and he'll be able to take advantage.
Yeah, I mean, people that don't know, Chico is Pickett is a very veteranized fighter, 24-9. Has been in there with a lot of the best in the world, has experience on his side, definitely. I just think that a guy like Chico coming in, the way that he fights, I think he's going to prove to be too much. I think he's going to set a pace that Pickett will try and match but won't be able to, and he'll falter in a decision loss to Chico Camus. Calling it.
All right, we'll see about that. And I think Pickett's also 36 years old. He's getting up there.
So he's getting up there, exactly.
He's coming probably towards the latter years of his career.
You never know when Father Time wants to be a little bitch and just take the,
I don't know if that's yet, but we'll see.
We'll see. I mean, you never know.
It's one of those fights that aren't exactly the biggest name guys, but it's an exciting fight. It should be fun.
Definitely. We move on to the co-main event of the evening. Bobby King Green, ranked number 7 at lightweight, who is coming off the heels of his biggest win of his entire career against Josh Thompson, versus Edson Barboza. Number 13 ranked, one of the best up and coming. I guess you can't even say that about him anymore. He's somewhat veteranized at this point.
Yeah.
But he's there. He's there, and he's one of the toughest guys at lightweight, definitely. And this makes for an exciting lightweight affair. A lot of people were actually complaining about this fight because it's a step down for Bobby coming off. But he needed a fight. I mean, he had a fight against Cerrone up until it got, nicked in exchange for putting Eddie Alvarez in there for obvious reasons. That was a more exciting fight for fans. And Bobby Green gets an exciting fight here. Edson Barboza is a tough customer, man. And
Barboza might have came off a loss to Cerrone, but this guy is no joke. He could beat anyone in the division on a given night. But I think it might be a little bit of a step down for Bobby Green, but that fight with Thompson was also really close. I thought he lost that fight, but still, it should be. This one's another one that's just really exciting, and it has a potential fight of the night.
You thought he lost that one? You thought Bobby lost that one, or the?
Yeah, I thought Bobby lost the fight to Josh Thompson. Really?
I remember correctly. I think, or if I remember correctly, Bobby, to me, won 2 rounds. I'd have to go back and watch it, but
it was a really odd fight.
It was. It was weird. Bobby was doing that whole thing where he's, dancing around somewhat. He has that awkward striking style. In which here against Edson, I don't think that's gonna fly. I think, especially for a guy who can attack from the outside as well as Edson can, spinning back kicks, spinning heel kicks, leg kicks, body kicks, that dude's gonna attack him with a Muay Thai, and it's gonna be madness. I think Bobby definitely needs to utilize his wrestling in this fight. He's a great wrestler. He rarely ever shows it, but he is. He's a great grappler in general. In which is why I said earlier at the start of the podcast, he's one of the best overall guys, and that's the reason why he's ranked at number 7. While he likes to show off that flashy striking style, he could take the fight anywhere and be successful, especially in this fight, definitely. And
the thing about Barboza, he does have pretty good takedown defense.
He does.
The only guy who was really able to take him down was Danny Castillo, and even he struggled a little bit, and Castillo's a really good wrestler.
Definitely. And I think that's attributed to his time at the Henzo Gracie Jiu-Jitsu Academy, as well as, training with the guy who will be competing in the main event, Frank Yeager, training partner. It's definitely you can see the improvements he's made over the short while that he's been around. I think he's been around since 2011, I want to say. I'm not exactly sure.
Yeah.
But it sounds about right. I think Bobby that
– I think Bobby Green, to win this fight, he's going to have to mix it up a lot. He's going to have to use his movement when he strikes just to stay out of the way of Barbosa's kicks, because they're just deadly. He has to stay out of the way of those kicks, stay out of the way of his punches. And even though I'm pretty sure Bobby Green's the shorter guy coming into this, not by much, but I think he is a smaller guy. He's going to have to just use his movement.
He's going to do it. I mean, for one thing that Bobby has, he has – his flashy striking style is backed up by good footwork. It's why he's able to get out of the way of many shots. It's why he's able to, not take too much damage. He's got great footwork. He can get in and out if he decides to go in there completely serious, doesn't mess around, and goes in and out and just, you know, basically puts on a clinic on this guy. He would have to. He's going to have to eat some kicks, definitely coming on the out, like on the exit, probably. Probably some leg kicks, some body kicks. He's got to watch out for any other kicks going higher. You know what I mean? He's got to be able to stay defensively sound throughout the entire fight, because Edson can throw anything that could end the fight, even a leg kick.
I mean, Barbosa, yeah, you really got to watch out with any of his kicks, to be honest. You got to watch out for the leg kicks. You got to watch out for the body kicks. They're just as dangerous as his head kicks, because he throws so hard. And, I mean, the thing about Bobby Green, his defense is really good. He uses that Philly shell style defense, and he uses it well. He's able to block a lot of body shots, block a lot of head shots. He's able to frustrate guys. And if he's able to frustrate Barbosa and make him take a lot of risk, then he could start shooting takedowns and just mixing it up. And maybe he'll be able to find the win by using his wrestling more so than his striking against a guy like Barbosa.
I think in this – and that's the thing about Barbosa. He's so good where you really have to be on your game when you fight this guy, because if you don't, he'll put you down in any way possible with leg kicks, head kicks. But he's knocked some dudes out with his hands before. He's got many weapons that he can use in this fight, and – yeah, Bobby's going to have to be at the top of his game here for this fight. It's going to be a tough one. I am personally going to back Bobby Green. I think there's no stopping this dude right now. I think he's at the top of his game, and so I think that he's going to be prepared.
I like to agree. I think I am favoring Bobby Green slightly, but I don't know. This one's a tough one to call.
It just doesn't feel comfortable having to back anybody against Edson Barbosa. That's, for me, kind of what my dilemma is.
It really doesn't. I mean, the two losses he had were the Jamie Varner loss, which was like, it seemed like it was kind of flukish. It just happened, which it does happen. it did seem flukish. Jamie Varner, no knock on him, but the fight, it seemed flukish. It didn't seem like Barbosa was ready for Varner to come out that strong. And then he did have that close Castillo decision, and then he lost to Donald Cerrone, which, I mean, that's Cowboy. I think Cowboy, on any given night, if Cowboy comes 100%, he's a championship material guy.
I can't believe you said that was a flukish fight. This is the second consecutive podcast where you're saying controversial things. You're trying to get us shut it down, Chris. I won't have it.
I don't know. I can't knock Jamie Varner. That guy's a tough guy. He comes to fight every time.
One of the best comebacks of last year, for sure.
Yeah, it was very surprising. It was very surprising that he won that fight.
Yeah.
And then the Cerrone fight, I mean, Cerrone's just, he's a monster. And Barbosa was doing well in that fight until Cerrone caught him. But, and then he did beat Evan Dunham in his last fight with that kick to the body. And he has the ability to do that to anyone. But I think Bobby Green's hot right now. I'm going to go with him as well.
Awesome. And the main event of the evening, one of my personal favorites, so I might be biased in my choosing of this fight. Cub Swanson. My opinion, the number one ranked guy in the featherweight division at this point, versus Frankie the Answer Edgar, the former UFC lightweight champion, in a fight that possibly could determine the next number one contender. You never know with how crazy it is right now, just because of the name Conor McGregor. But let's just assume that, assuming Cub Swanson wins this fight, that he would get the title shot.
Well, Dana White did say that if Swanson wins, he will get the title shot.
Yeah, but he also said that Conor McGregor makes sense, and I say quote-unquote makes sense.
He did say he makes sense because he's the only guy out of the three of them that hasn't fought Jose Aldo yet.
This is definitely a topic we will need to discuss after we're done talking about this fight, I think, just real quick. Because it's a heavy topic with a lot of people right now. And it's good because it's garnering a lot of attention for the featherweight division.
Yeah.
But it's frustrating me.
The featherweight division, along with Conor, a lot of guys are seeing how well he's doing just talking, and a lot of guys are being a lot more vocal than they usually have been. Yeah. I mean, when did you really ever hear Ricardo Lamas say anything? And even guys like Dennis Bermudez, he was a fun guy, but he never really said anything controversial up until McGregor started talking.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, Conor is showing how bad he is an influence here. I would just hope not to this degree. I would think that, looking at Cub Swanson, the man is on a 6-fight win streak right now. That is ridiculousness. Especially when you look at who he's beating. I mean, I know that Dennis Bermudez was on a 7-fight win streak, but it wasn't against the kind of competition that Cub Swanson has beaten.
Yeah. I completely agree.
And let's just go down the list here. I mean, oh my goodness. Jeremy Stevens in his very last fight recently this summer. And Dustin Poirier, Charles Oliveira being, you know, one of the mere tier fighters, but he's definitely a tough fighter to beat. He's a
dangerous guy.
He's a very dangerous guy. Yeah, Dennis Seaver finished him. The guy who Conor McGregor will fight next knocked out Ross Pearson, dude.
And George Roop.
I mean, George Roop is George Roop, but I mean, he knocked him out too. I mean.
Yeah, his only losses come from one of those guys. His only losses have come, aside from he did lose
to the top, to three of the top five guys.
He lost to Jens Pulver when Jens Pulver was one of the best guys. He lost to Jose Aldo, Chad Mendes, and Ricardo Lamas.
Those are three of the top five best fighters at featherweight right now. Exactly. I would say. My argument is that.
Yeah, no, of course they are.
According to our rankings, that's what we say, and I think that's what they are, because and that makes sense. And he's beaten a lot of tough guys since, and I think that now is the time for him to really, really, really cement his spot as the number one contender against Frankie the Answer Edgar. Frankie Edgar himself coming off a very dominating win against the former lightweight champion BJ Penn. That's kind of sad. I'm like, I'm
in his own right.
I'm sorry.
Frank Edgar is a former champion in his own right.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's what makes this fight a very classic fight, possible in the making, definitely, because these guys are no jokes in their division, and Frankie Edgar, man, he's one of the best guys I feel at mixing it up like no other. He can take you down when he thinks he's gonna come in with a punch. The dude has footwork like a gnat. Battle gnat, you know, he enters, he exits, he's quick, he's strong, deceptively strong. He has many great weapons. Swanson.
What do you think this fight's gonna?
Well, for me, the way I see it, I see for Cub Swanson, what he has to do on defensively, he has to be almost perfectly technically sound. He has to be able to see when Frankie Edgar's coming. He has to be able to see that timing. He also has to be ready for that takedown. He has to be ready for a lot of things, which sucks because that means having to be defensive. He also has to form a very tight-knit kind of offense. He has to be, because Frankie Edgar's not easy to hit. He moves around a lot. He's fast. You got to be fast. The way Jose Aldo was able to shut him down is because he's fast. He was able to throw good kicks on him. Swanson's not known for being a heavy kicker. I would think he should just be able to, you know, set up his combinations with kicks. That being said, it's very hard to really call this fight. It is extremely hard.
Does throw him.
Say that again?
Hub does have some flashy kicks when he does throw them.
Oh, definitely, yeah. I mean, he's thrown some wild. I mean, remember that spinning back, spinning heel kick he landed on a Ross Pearson?
Yeah.
Like, he, like, kind of clipped him with it, and then it made him bounce off against the cage, and then just boom, Swanson just edged on, just put him down. This is such a master class fight, I believe, because these guys are two dudes with some of the best skills in all of their, of MMA in general, not just their divisions. And they're two of the best in their divisions for sure. It's a great fight. It was one of the fights that when it was announced, I was most excited for to close out the year. And I believe if Cubs, I don't know about Frankie Edgar. It's tougher with Frankie Edgar because he's only coming off two wins. One win being against BJ Penn, which is a huge win. Many people don't consider it that. But we'll get into that in a minute.
Yeah, I don't think Frankie gets the title shot with a win over Swanson, but I think Swanson gets it with a win over Edgar.
Well, because it's the seventh in a row with another ranked fight, and it's just
I think for the UFC, if they want Conor McGregor to get the next title shot, it's better if Frank Edgar wins this fight.
Definitely. And so with all that said, I think it's Swanson's time. I believe it's his time. I think he's going to be ready. I follow him closely. I'm a huge fan. And the training that he's doing, frankly, I haven't. So it's hard. With that, it makes it a little harder for me. I'm also biased. I'm a huge fan. But I believe it's his time. I think he's going to go in there. I think he's going to be ready for Frankie's movement. I think he's going to have his timing, his rhythm down. And he's going to be able to plant his feet right when the time comes and land that punch and put Frankie Edgar down.
Yeah, I come from a similar camp when I about being a big fan. I'm a really big fan of Frank Yeager. He's from New Jersey. It's not. He's from the area, basically. I'm in New York. He's in Jersey. I've met him before. He's a really nice guy. And, I mean, I just can't root against him. I'll never pick against the guy. And when you look at his fights, like, the fights with Benson Henderson, the first fight was very close, and it could have went either way. The second fight, I thought it was clearly Frank Yeager's fight. And even the Jose Aldo fight, it was another really close fight. He arguably could have won all three of those fights, and he could be a two-division champion. And I think outside of Jose Aldo, barring maybe Chad Mendes, Frankie's the best guy in the division. The only thing is when you look at his last few fights, like not even his last few, but like a good amount of them, he's fought BJ Penn three times. He's fought Gray Maynard twice, Benson Henderson twice. He's fought a lot of the same guys. So
the master of the rematch.
Yeah, he has a lot of rematches, Frankie. And I think in this fight, the way Frankie's going to have to win is how he always wins. Cub's a bigger guy. He's a longer ranger guy. And I think Cub's going to have to look to keep Frankie on the outside, keep a lot of straight punches, and maybe throw some more kicks than he's used to throwing. And he's going to have to be sound with his takedown defense. Cub does have good takedown defense, and he has good takedowns of his own. But he's going to have to be really sound with his takedown defense. And even though Frankie does prefer to stand in most fights, and he uses that head movement and his movement of his feet, his footwork, to get inside of guys and then use his punches, and he's a really sound boxer. I think Frankie is a better boxer than Cub in his own right, especially on the inside of things, just using those angles to find openings. And I think he's going to be able to do that in this fight. And if Cub, and I don't think Cub will be able to keep him on the outside because of that frantic head movement Frankie does use a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he'll be able to find a few takedowns when he wants to. And I think that might be the difference in this fight. If Frankie's able to get Cub down, Frankie's going to win this fight. The guy, and Cub is good off his back. He has good submissions himself, but Frankie's never been finished in his career. And he's had a pretty long career. And the guy is, he seems like he's unsubmittable. He's been rocked a lot, but he's never been finished. And he's just one of the toughest guys. He has so much heart. And I think, especially another point that brings me to is just, it's a 5-round fight. I think that gives Frankie a big advantage. This guy has a gas tank. And Cub doesn't have the same experience in 5-round fights that Frankie does. And Frankie gets better as the fight goes on, where I'm not sure if that's the same for Cub. So if Frankie's able to take this into deep waters, I think he comes out on top.
Bold and possibly true words, Chris. I don't know if I want to admit it, but
good breakdown. Yeah, it should be a really fun fight. It seems like it's going to be a close one, but I think this fight, I think this fight's going to be good. I really do. And I think Frankie's going to come out on top, like I think he should have been a lot of his fights that he lost. I don't think it's going to be the same close decision as like the Benson Henderson fights, just because Cub isn't the same wrestler. He isn't able to compete in the wrestling, in my opinion, against Frankie. I think if Cub wins his fight, he's going to have to finish.
Definitely. As I said, I believe he's going to have his defensive and offensive striking on key point. Because he's gonna need to catch this guy. He's gonna need to put him, get his respect early, and he's gonna need to put the hands on him right. And he's gonna have to be sharp. He's gonna have to be quick and sharp and technical, and that's really hard to do all at the same time. But I believe Cup can get it done. I believe
this should be one of the most fun fights of the year. And both of these guys are always fun to watch.
Definitely. I mean, I couldn't have thought of a better way to close out the year. As far as with a fight night card, I know it's not the last one, but it's one of the most easily exciting ones that there have been all year, as far as main events go.
I think if Frankie wins his fight, they're going to give him another fight before he gets a title shot if he wins.
I would personally, I would love it if Frank Yeager just happened to fight Conor McGregor and or Chad Money Mendez. Those two fights make the most sense.
I mean, I do think the Lamas Ricardo Lamas, I think him and Mendez are going to wind up throwing down just because...
If that doesn't happen, yeah.
I mean, I don't think Dennis Seaver is going to fall out of the fight with McGregor. I think McGregor is going to win that fight. If Frankie wins here, McGregor is probably going to get the title shot because Frankie did just fight Jose Aldo only a little bit over a year ago. And I don't know. Who else would there be for Frankie coming into the... I mean, because if Lamas and Mendes get matched up, if McGregor gets a title shot, who's around for Frankie to fight?
I don't know. But we'll get there when we get there. We have the time.
We gotta wait on this fight first. It should be interesting.
See where it goes, and then we'll talk about it when the time is right. We are done breaking that one down. We've actually garnered some questions from some of you MMAD fans that I've been able to get a hold of, and I thank you very much for them. Me and Chris, we're going to break these questions down before we head on out of here. This one by Brian Ashcraft, returning member. Are you ready for these questions, Chris?
I am ready. I am ready as ever.
Let's do it, bro. All right. What do you prefer, fighters with beef or fighters who have great respect for each other, such as Kelvin Gastelum and Tyron Woodley? This is coming off a Twitter exchange where it wasn't even an exchange. It was just, you know, some basic respect thrown back and forth once they realized that they were fighting each other. They just said, hashtag respect back and forth. What is your opinion on this?
It doesn't matter too much to me. I really just like to see, like, that's going to be a great fight between Kelvin Gastelum and Tyron Woodley. And, I mean, I just like to see good fights. If I think a fight's going to be a good fight, I'm going to watch it. But I think a little bit, the added beef just adds something into it. If the guy's talking, it just makes the fight more, like, anticipated, even though it depends on the level of fight. Like, if it's a high-level fight, I'm going to be excited no matter what. But let's just say, like, even Conor McGregor versus Dennis Seaver, just because Conor's been talking so much, it makes it more exciting. And fights that there's beef in, even though it might not be the most exciting fight, it just amps it up a little bit. And if it is going to be, like, the most exciting fight, it amps it up a lot. I think fights with beef are a little bit more fun for fans. But either way, I'm glad watching a fight regardless if it's going to be a good fight.
Definitely. I personally, doesn't matter to me as well. There's two different types of feels you get for a fight where you know there's a lot of respect. What I don't like generally is if there's like too much respect once, you know, like going into the very beginning of the fight, they decide to just like hug it out real quick. That kind of tells you what mindset both guys are in. They're not in the killer mindset yet. They're not in that, I got to kill this guy. I got to put him down. I got to get out of this cage with this guy. I mean, I got to do that. I got to take his head off. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I get exactly what you mean. I mean, if guys come out and hug and then they go at it, I'm happy with that. But the best example of what you're saying is probably the Uriah Hall-John Howard fight where it was just overdone and it was a really bad fight and they just kept touching gloves over and over again.
They looked like brothers doing a sparring session. It was weird.
It was just very weird. And I think when it's overdone like that, it can be a bit frustrating, but if guys just come hug it out and they have a ton of respect for each other, or if they're even friends fighting, and then they go at it, I'm fine with that regardless.
Yeah, or it's a cool thing when they do that, like, in the last round, and it's a close fight, I guess. The cool thing about beef is that when it's real and you feel it and you know it's real, and you can't wait to see what's going on. Those are the kind of fights that, you know, basically made the fighting business, you know?
Yeah, and it basically brings more eyeballs to the sport, especially in a big fight. If you have a guy going at it and people are like, oh, man, these guys really, they want to fight. It brings kind of like that, a little bit, that street mentality into it where people go crazy over a fight because these guys have real beef. Mm-hmm. And it's professional fighting, so it's like, these guys fight at the highest level possible, and they have beef, so this might be something special.
Yeah, but see, there's the other side of that coin, is if, what if it's, like, kind of force-fed? What if it doesn't seem real? What if it seems fake? What if it seems... Yeah, that kind of beef. When you got that, then it's just, like, a turn-off. It's just like, ugh.
At times, but, mm-hmm. It really depends, like... I mean, that doesn't happen all too often where guys, like, pretend to have beef. And, I mean, if the fight's still good, it's still good. That's really what matters the most to me.
Definitely. And, I mean, at the end of the day, a good fight is all that matters to me. Whether they have respect for each other or not, as long as they go out there and they show off who's the better fighter, that's what I'm most excited about. As far as preference, I don't have any. I want it more than anything. I want fighters to keep it real. If they have respect for each other, that's awesome. If they hate each other, that's also awesome. I don't want you to go out there and pretend to be somebody you're not, though.
Yeah, I mean, I don't mind when guys, like, amp up their personalities a little bit just for some recognition, just to get things, like, to make a name for themselves, because that's great. If you're able to market yourself in a good way, I mean, go for it. You only have a limited amount of time to make money in this sport, but fabricated beef isn't like the best unless you can do it well, like a guy like Chael Sonnen can. I mean,
yeah.
Even with him, it's not it. It, well, I'm not sure if it was really fabricated. He just like played a character himself.
Yeah, and he admits that. And you know, but yeah. See, the thing about that is that it made people hate him. You know, if the thing about him was that if he could, whether or not he hated somebody or not, or just truly dislikes him, he made other people really dislike him. You know,
yeah.
He made other people not like him, and that you couldn't fake what those people were feeling, what they wanted. You know,
exactly. And I think if this sport, it's not like it's not a long lived sport. A lot of the guys aren't making money from just fighting. You have to make a name for yourself. You have to get yourself sponsors. You have to be able to make some money. That's what it comes down to when you just go out there and amp up your personality a little bit.
Mm-hmm. A great question by Brian Ashcraft on MMA.
Yeah,
thank
definitely.
You. Which main event fight are you most looking forward to? And this question coming from Ashley Simmons with a Z. Nice. Good question. I personally, it's a tie between two events. I don't know if I'm allowed to tie it, but I'm gonna go with a tie between Anthony Johnson and Alexander Gustafsson, and John Jones versus Daniel Cormier. Right now, the 205 pound division has me, you know, by the sack, because those two fights are just salivating. I mean, those are awesome fights. The yeah. division right now is coming together right now, and those are the two fights that really are just it's palpable. It's awesome, and I'm sold on it, and I want to see it, and I can't wait to see it.
Yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to that Gustafsson Johnson fight, and I'm gonna go with a tie too, not just to bite off you, but I mean, these fights are two that I'm really looking forward to. I am also going to say John Jones versus Daniel Cormier, just because these guys are basically, I mean, you can't really count Jones' loss, they're basically undefeated. Cormier presents a challenge that John Jones has never really seen before, and that fight should just be outstanding. And I, even though Jones could just make it look like another easy fight or just have his way with Cormier using his reach, I think that fight's going to be really fun to watch. And my other fight is Anderson Silva versus Nick Diaz. Mm-hmm. I mean, that fight... Anderson Silva is my all-time favorite fighter. He's one of the biggest reasons why I got into MMA. And this guy, I really just want to see how he comes back from his injury, how he comes back from the losses. And Nick Diaz is always just a guy who's gonna talk some trash. He even like in the fight, he's just a fun guy to watch. He has a really cool style of boxing. And I want to see just how Anderson comes back. That's like a big question in everyone's mind. Can he come back? Can he be the same Anderson Silva, or is he done? That's something I really am looking forward to seeing.
Yeah, that's a fight in itself right there, and I wish it wasn't as far away as it is, but that's a great fight still.
I mean, it's not too far, right?
Not too far, it's at the end of January.
Yeah.
I mean, and there's still so many fights that we're going to get in the meantime.
So many good fights listed, it's just that with the UFC, it's just like one injury can kill a card. I'm hoping everyone stays healthy.
Oh, I know. The worst one, I think, if there was a worser injury, or if there was an injury that could really just absolutely just massacre a card, it would have to be Alexander Gustafsson, because the event is going to be held in Sweden. Not only is it going to be held in Sweden, it's going to be held from what I understand, it's going to be held in a stadium that holds 30,000 people. And when that first was announced, people were like, are you sure that's a good idea? You know, a lot of people, a lot of media were was, you know, questioning whether or not this was a smart idea. Me personally, I think that, you know, it's smart because you're using your number one Sweden, you know, guy. I mean, because Sweden.
Yeah, there aren't very many guys in the UFC.
Yeah. The last two events they did in Sweden, they didn't have Gustafsson, you know.
Isn't he supposed to fight Ilir Latifi in Sweden? Or not?
Gegard Mousasi, yeah.
And then. Latifi filled in because he got hurt.
Yeah, he got a cut in his head and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now,
as of right now, this fight card isn't the most stacked. Like underneath Gustafsson Johnson, there's Dan Henderson Mousasi, which is a good fight. And then aside from that, there aren't really many other fights, at least for now.
At least for now, it has time to build. Definitely.
Oh, definitely.
It's in mid January right now. It's
late,
you know,
January even. It's not for another. What is that?
That's about 2 months. Exactly 2 months away.
They have time to add a few.
I'm sure come December they're going to really start stacking that card up.
It's a fight night, so who knows? They might not stack it up too much, but I mean, it'll probably get a few more fights.
Yeah, we'll see. And once it does, we'll talk about it. Thank you, Ashley, for that question. Yes. Who are your nominees for Fighter of the Year, and explain your criteria? This is a loaded question.
That's a hard one.
That's a very hard one. I mean, especially when you just...
We are coming to the end of the year, though.
We are. I mean, it's November, coming up on the end of November now, and we only have, like, as far as the UFC is concerned, there's only like four fight cards left, correct?
Yeah, something like that. There aren't too many. I'm not sure the exact amount.
Four, I think that's it. I mean, there's the one coming up this weekend. There's UFC 181. There's UFC on Fox 13. And then, the Ultimate Fighter finale. And then added the UFC Fight Night in Brazil. That will be headlined by Leonardo Machida and CB Dolloway. So that's five. Which is crazy. Those are a lot of events to close out the end of the year. A lot of people like to put their criteria on who like has that many wins or finishes, in which case if you had to, you would want to go with Donald Cerrone.
Cerrone's definitely up there.
Yeah, or I mean if you wanted to go with the amount of wins, you would go with Neil Magny because he has already five.
I mean, I wouldn't go with Neil Magny just because of the level of competition.
Exactly. So then there within lies, you know, you got to really find some middle ground with all these.
Yeah, I think my criteria, it comes down to, I think you have to have at least three fights on the year. And they have to be high-level competition for the most part. You can't be – I mean, Neil Magny is streaks impressive, but he hasn't been fighting top 15 guys. You have to be fighting top guys. That's why champions usually do win this award, but a lot of the champions haven't fought too much this year.
Yeah, I mean, which is odd when you think about how many cards there's been. You know what I mean?
It's because they're
and there's actually been, you know, some changing of the guard moments throughout the year, such as TJ Dolloway, the new interim heavyweight champion Fabricio. Fabricio's had a year. I mean,
You
know, beating top contender Travis Brown, and then you know, recording the only flying knee of a heavyweight division I've ever seen. Against the toughest chin dude in the entire division, you know what I mean? Definitely a he could get a vote strictly off, you know, winning a belt and in the fashion that he's done it, and mainly I think career comebacks, he wins that. Or as far as like, you know, career comeback of the year, if that was a nominee. But that's not, it's fight of the year. And so I'm trying to think. Max Holloway comes up, but only because, you know, he's also fought four times this year with four finishes.
Yeah, I just don't think the level of competition. I think it has to be someone with a higher level of competition.
Yeah, and see, that sucks because you can't say Demetrius Johnson either because, like...
You know what I think's up there? Flying under the radar a little bit on this?
What's up?
Luke Rockhold.
Three finishes, that's true.
Three fights, he's fought top-ranked guys in the division.
Definitely.
He's 3-0 on the year.
Yeah, what was it? Kostas Filipou, Michael Bisping just recently, and in the middle of that is somebody, Tim Boesch. That's right, crazy Kimura.
Those guys, they were top ranked.
They are all ranked. They're still all ranked. As far as the UFC rankings in the 15, they're all ranked.
And when he beat them, they were even higher ranked than they are at the time. So, I mean, that's something impressive. Who else has fought a lot this year? I'm trying to think.
I don't know. I mean...
How many times did Robbie Lawler fought?
He's fought three times. He's coming. Oh, okay. Here's what happens. If Robbie Lawler wins his fight against Johnny Hendricks, that'll be his fourth fight this year, his third win. Because
his
fought.
Only loss was that close fight to Hendricks.
Was that close fight to Hendricks?
If Robbie Lawler beats Johnny Hendricks, you could definitely give it to him this
time. Mainly because, you know, he comes into the year, loses the title fight, but decides to get off his ass and not cry about it and goes and just starches two – well, not starches, but yeah, he defeats Jake Ellenberger in devastating fashion and then goes on to have a crazy war with Matt Brown in which he earned his title rematch. And if he was able to go in there and defeat Johnny Hendricks in the same year of which he lost him at the beginning of the year, it just shows you such a comeback, and only because it shows that that guy was not willing to just lay down and let that loss sink in. He got right back in there, decided to fight, and decided to, you know, hey, I was close. I won't let that mistake happen again. And that's what's exciting about that fight. That's also, as far as this year goes, that's the headliner I'm excited about the most. Because that's a crazy good fight.
And, I mean, you can even throw in Anthony Johnson in there.
Definitely. I mean, he's only had two fights.
Two finishes, two knockouts.
Yeah.
I mean, Mike Kyler isn't the highest level of competition, but he beat Phil Davis soundly, and he knocked out Antonio Ruggiero.
Yeah, man, this is hard. It's just because, you know, I mean, there's been a lot of fighters, not mainly champions, but there's been a lot of fighters that have done great this year, putting on great streaks like Max Holloway, Neil Magny, Donald Cerrone, Luke Rockhold, Kendall Johnson. There's all these guys that are going in there, and they're doing crazy good in all of their respective divisions. As far as champions, yeah, they've had a hard time competing. I think Chris has only competed once this year. Johnny Hendricks only thus far competed once. He'll compete again next month.
Yeah, the champions are usually like John Jones has been winning it for years. I think he's won the last 2 years, if I'm not mistaken. But
he's only fought once this year, and that's mainly because of injuries. Yeah.
I mean, if I'm going to go with someone at the moment right now, it's going to be Donald Cerrone.
All right, yeah, and I think for right now, I'll stay with I'll live with you on that, Donald Cerrone. But if Robbie Lawler wins the title, I change my vote to Robbie Lawler.
I would probably give it to Robbie.
I think I will. I'll just have to.
I mean, slightly to Robbie Lawler,
unless it's a robbery,
because Robbie Lawler's faced a little bit of higher level competition, but and he would have won the title. But I mean, Donald Cerrone, he knocked out Jim Miller. He submitted Edson Barboza. He knocked out Martins with that highlight reel knockout on that kick.
Yep.
And then, I mean, he beat up Eddie Alvarez for most of that fight.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I would go Cerrone right now, but if Robbie Lawler wins, he's in there, and you can put Rockhold and Anthony Johnson in that conversation as well.
Definitely, dude. We'll go with this last question here. Which awesome. Divisions would you like to see on upcoming seasons of The Ultimate Fighter here in the States, and with coaches? Well, yeah, I mean, that's just kind of the consensus of what everybody wants. I think it's just such a hard division to really get marquee talent for.
Yeah.
You know, like talent, like talented guys. I mean, I'm sure there are heavyweights out there that could compete.
Yeah, but when you see big guys like that, a lot of them are, if a guy's that big and athletic, they're probably playing another sport.
Yeah.
And like, I mean,
like Matt Mitrione, you know, guys who've competed in other sports, you know.
Yeah, like, I mean, it's hard. There are a few other divisions you could do. I mean, there's a lot of fading guys at light heavyweight. Even though the top of the division's pretty good, you can always argue for a light heavyweight one.
I wouldn't mind a flyweight one. That's not a bad idea either. Flyweight could use some package.
You know? Maybe they do. I mean, yeah, it depends. If you can find enough guys for flyweight, that could be a fun one too.
Mm-hmm.
And what about coaches?
As far as coaches, I mean, that's hard mainly because when you think of coaches, you want to think of either, you know, championship guys and the contenders, or two, you know, veteranized guys, you know, just kind of going in there.
You want to see guys, but you want to see guys with beef, guys who are going to talk a lot just because it makes the show more fun.
Mm-hmm. I would say,
like, you have guys this year like Pettis and Melendez, they're not, like, in the show because they don't talk at all.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people were all amped when Gilbert brought the Diaz brothers in, but they don't do much.
Oh, yeah, they haven't even shown them.
They're on their best behavior. It's kind of funny.
At the moment, I mean, I don't know if they would do this, and if it happens, if Conor McGregor beats Dennis Siver and they put Conor McGregor and Jose Aldo in there, that would be fun.
That would be fun, man. That would be wicked. It'd be weird, though, because Conor hasn't been in the UFC that long to even warrant being a coach.
It would just be fun.
It would definitely be fun.
And I don't know how good Aldo's English isn't too great, so that might not be...
Yeah, I mean, they would probably tough Brazil that up and probably just, you know, send Conor down there, even though, you know, people want to kill him.
That seems like that would be the more likely outcome, but, I mean, I don't know. I'm trying to think of, like, what would be something good.
Yeah, and it's hard because there's not a lot of veteranized guys to where they can make coaches like that. I mean, what would have been cool, well, not really, mainly because Frankie's already coached the Ultimate Fighter, but what would have been cool would have been Cub and Frankie. But, you know, it's already coming
Frankie
to pass.
Frankie recently
but.
Coached. It's just a hard thing to just think about because we don't know who's fighting who coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Like, all these fights that are already going to happen, we can't put those guys in it because it's too soon.
Yeah.
It's
tough.
It would probably... I'm not too sure. It's hard because a lot of these champions...
Okay, say this, though. I have a very hypothetical, and it's very awesome. So, say Nick Diaz beats Anderson Silva. Say that happens. And Dana White has said this. Came from his own mouth. If he won, he could definitely be worthy of a title shot. In which a lot of people agree, disagree, whatever, what have you. He gets that title shot, say against Robbie Lawler or Johnny Hendricks. That would be a great coaching season, I think.
You could do that. I mean, I'm trying. It's just like you want. That sounded the worst idea, but I don't know if Nick beats Anderson. It's a little bit.
Like I said, it's a very big hypothetical. You know.
I mean, John Jones recently coached. I mean, in my opinion, I think they should just put the Ultimate Fighter in America to an end.
Oh! No, you didn't!
I think they have to.
Oh.
It's not
really, maybe. I don't know.
It has produced pretty good talent in the last few years. Mm-hmm. They've gotten a decent amount of really good guys out of it, like Dillashaw. They got Dotson. I mean, and they've gotten guys like Ally, Quinta, Miles, Sturry. But I think it's been going on for so long, it's getting a little played out.
Mm-hmm. And it's not like every season. You only get every few seasons a real good competitor. You get like your Kelvin Gastelums or...
Gastelum, Ally, Quinta,
or your TJ Dillashaws, you know.
We've gotten good guys out of there, but I mean, I don't think the return is as much as they expect it to be, and I don't think putting on a whole season to have like one guy be good in the UFC maybe is worth a whole season of that show.
Mm-hmm.
And what they've been doing with it, they've been putting a lot of injured champions in it just to make sure they're on TV still. Like Pettis, they put in Dominic Cruz when he was injured. They've been putting a lot of guys in just to like give them more shelf life, and they have a reason not to be fighting until the end of the show.
Yeah.
If John Jones got hurt, they stashed him on there with Chael.
What would be funny is if say John Dodson came back from injury and they decided to have Johnson and Dodson coaches.
I mean,
coaching like big dudes, like, I don't know how that would work.
I don't think the show as serves its purpose anymore, and I don't think it's fun anymore. This season was only fun because it's a whole new division. I don't think they're going to do that again, so I really don't think there's a purpose to it. I think the UFC has way too many fighters, as we discussed last time, and I don't think the Ultimate Fighter is the answer for their to add a depth into divisions.
Definitely. I mean, we'll see. I mean, I'm sure that the UFC is not going to do that, but that's not a bad opinion to have, I guess, now that I've heard you out, even though at first I was like,
what? They haven't announced coaches yet, which is kind of weird.
That is true, but
they usually have the
coaches. Yeah, I mean, they have announced it for Brazil thus far. They haven't announced it for Latin America, even though they are auditioning for it already. I haven't heard anything about auditioning for the next season yet. That is true. That's interesting. Yeah, and usually, they either do it in early spring or late spring. Or like in the winter, in January. You know?
Kill it.
Put it out of its misery. You know who would agree with you is MMAD admin Adam. He doesn't watch it anymore. He watches the fights. He doesn't watch the show. He doesn't watch it
anymore. Yeah, I mean, a lot of people do that. A ton of people do that. That I know of. A lot of, especially journalists, they don't want to watch the show anymore. I mean, I just watch it because why not? Just because it's on and it's MMA. I mean, especially with this new division. This year, I've actually been interested because it's a whole new they have that tournament system set up. They have a championship on the line, so it is interesting. But they're not going to be able to do this again, so why watch it?
I would like if they did season 4, the comeback. Get some dudes.
Oh, that would be fun. That would be another reason to keep people watching. And maybe they do that. Maybe they just don't have coaches. Bring back fighters like that. That would be something fun to do.
That could definitely reinvigorate a fighter's career, especially one that's in the UFC struggling, but you never know, could find revitalization.
Aside from that, I don't think that there's much left for the Ultimate Fighter.
All right. Tough words, bro. I mean, I got no pun intended, but wow. That's crazy. We'll end off on there. I think that's a good key to end off right there. Definitely awesome podcast.
Yeah,
happy to have you on.
Everyone, you can go to the site sportsofanarchy.com, not Sons of Anarchy, Sports of Anarchy, and you can go on there. We're looking for new writers, so if anyone, MMA fan, or even just you want to write for anything else, definitely just contact me through either my Twitter, which is at Chris Pagliuca, and you can find Sports of Anarchy on Twitter at Sports of Anarchy, or on Facebook, facebook.com/sportsofanarchy. You can get in contact with me any of those ways, and also I write. Aside from being the owner for Sports of Anarchy, I write for MMANuts.com, which is another MMA site, and you can find us all over, and go read that too for some MMA news, guys. Thanks for listening.
You work for two of the wackiest named websites that I've ever heard.
Yes, I do.
I was just saying, I mean, I already think it's crazy I work for this one, but it's an awesome site for anybody that hasn't.
It's fun to do. I really enjoyed doing it. It's starting up right now. It's been less than a month, or just around a month, and it's doing pretty well. I mean, it's a lot of fun just being able to create a little bit more creative control over things where it could just be fun. But it's coming up, and I mean, MMA Nuts is a good site too. It's a lot of good MMA news. They also have a podcast there. They're really good guys who I work for over there, and just check both of them out.
To follow me, I'm at NickTheFantom.com, or NickTheFantom.com, just NickTheFantom on Twitter. I'm not that big. to find me on Twitter, you can find me on Facebook to ever ask any questions that you may have with me about MMA Discussion fan page. Please let me know, because we are having issues with it. Any questions that you need, ask me, or on Twitter or Facebook. We'll wrap it up right there, Chris. Thanks for coming on again.
I really hope that Discussion page is able to come back live.
We're gonna make a comeback. It's happening really one way or another. And the fans,
if you need some Brazilian jiu-jitsu gear, Submission FC just came out with a bamboo gi, which is really comfortable. And there, I do have also their bamboo t-shirts and hemp shirts. They're really comfortable stuff. So use our promo code Sports of Anarchy 10 when you go over there, and you get 10% off of your entire order.
Deals. Can't pass them up, people. All right, buddy. I will talk to you soon. People, enjoy the fights this weekend. It's going to be an insane card. If you were going to miss it, you better have a damn good reason. All right, buddy. I'll talk to you guys soon. Fight fans, thanks for listening. We appreciate you. Go visit the sites. Go visit Twitter. Go visit us. Go listen to this. Spread the word. We're coming back. By the way, MMA Discussion, we're going to make that comeback on Facebook soon. We're also going to probably invent a Twitter handle for it at some point in the near future. Just for the purposes of spreading the podcast around. We appreciate your love, guys. We hear you. You guys have been getting back to me and all the other admins for fans of the MMA Deep page, and we appreciate your love. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Later.